Well, I'd like to thank you for joining me on this broadcast talking about the potential of robots as a next generation technology for clinical assessment of neurological disorders. To begin, I'd like to make a couple comments, and this is just what I like to call affectionately why you might ignore this talk. First, I'm a basic scientist and I'm new to clinical research. The second is I'm co-founder and CSO of Beacon Technologies that commercializes the robots for basic and clinical research. So I have a clear conflict of interest. However, I think both these aspects help me with the problem of what's called knowledge translation, valleys of death. And that I hope that being a basic scientist, it will help take and translate the ideas of using robots from basic biomedical research to clinical research and get through the valley of death one. And involved in commercialization is what I consider essential if we're going to ever get through the valley of death two, which is from clinical research to changing clinical practice. So what is the question I want to try to address with robots? Well, it's the problem of assessment because it drives the healthcare system. Does Sidney Crosby, who's shown on the left, have a concussion? And at what point is he able to go back to play? If you think about a drug, what is the right therapeutics? Does the drug work? And how is it effective? And finally, if someone, say, has a stroke, like in the bottom right diagram, what is the biggest problem they have? Is strength really the problem, or should we be addressing something else? And that's all driven by the assessment. Now, clinical assessment for brain function is traditionally done with rather simple tasks such as touch, nose, and finger. And you score it out of 0, 1, or 2. And there's several basic problems with this. Not most obvious is it's subjective. It's based on visual, physical inspection by the clinician. And by doing that, you have to have coarse scales, 0, 1, or 2. And that allows it to be consistent across clinicians. But it's very hard to show improvement when you have such a coarse rating system. The other problem is you get floor and ceiling effects with many of these techniques, whether it's a floor because you get a 0, but clearly there's different levels of impairment, or people could get a full score of 2, but still have some sort of impairments that are different from healthy controls. The other challenge is many of these take to cover all of the different aspects of brain function, they're very time consuming, and in many situations, they don't necessarily always practice and perform. So the overview is to try to persuade you about the potential of robots for neurological assessment. I'm going to go through and illustrate how we've been using robots for assessing sensory motor and cognitive function in subjects with stroke. And then I'll finish with some future directions we see we will be taking the technology. Now, basic research has been using robots for many, many years. So the diagrams on the left show some very various examples of robots that are exist and are available today and that are used to study basic motor control and motor learning. The diagram on the right is just to illustrate the broad circuits that are involved in this. And we've made a lot of headway in trying to understand how different areas of the brain, cerebellum, primary motor cortex provide specific information and in their involvement in control and learning. The basic premise for thinking about clinical assessment is, can we do the reverse process? If it's useful for basic research on the brain, why not clinical applications? So in my regular day job, I like to call it, I often try to understand non-human primates and neurophysiology about what neural activity is related to in different brain regions. I have an area like premotor cortex. I'm interested in understanding its involvement and control. I build tasks. I use the robot. I quantify behavior. And from that, try to identify, based on the neural activity patterns, what is the function of premotor cortex. And the idea is to do the same sort of principle with clinical assessment. You have a patient, there's something wrong with their brain. We can take that subject, put them into a robotic device, quantify their behavior through a range of different tasks, and from there identify what is the brain dysfunction. Why robots for neurological assessment? Well, they're inherently objective. You can quantify limb movement with the robots, and you can also control the movements precisely. They're easily combined with virtual reality to simulate complex scenarios. And importantly, they can automate tasks and analyses. Why the upper limb? Well, you can do a broad range of voluntary motor actions with your arms. It's easy to quantify whole limb movements. We have a very distributed network for involving upper limb perception and action. And so you can tap a large quantity of the brain circuits. And we can take advantage of the large body of research we already have developed on basic research of upper limb motor function for these developing these clinical tools. And finally, we can also use the arm as basically a readout of any cognitive processes we're interested in. So here's a video that will be displayed, and it's just showing the basic design of the kinarm exoskeleton robot. It's an exoskeleton robot. I'm not sure if it's displaying yet. But basically, it's showing a robot that we have at St. Mary's of the Lake Hospital. It's a local hospital in Kingston where we have set up the robot. And we set the subject up. And the subjects are adjusted by to adjust the shape of the robot. The subjects adjust, can move their arms in the horizontal plane, moving shoulder and elbow movements. And then they can be wheeled into a virtual reality system so they look down and can see virtual targets displayed in the horizontal plane. I can't see the video, so I'm not quite sure where we are at in it. The diagram is showing a very simple task of visual guided reaching where a central target turns on and the subjects simply reach out to the target as it's displayed in the same workspace as the limb. The diagram also shows, or the video also shows, the basic operating system where the operator can watch and monitor how the subject's performing the task. So that's that video. I'd like to now just skip quickly to a second video, which is going to show a reaching video. So this is a basic data of a healthy control subject performing reaching movements and a subject with stroke. And the subject on the left is the control subject. You'll see they move quickly and accurately to the spatial targets. And they make maybe one small corrective movement, but it's fairly simple to see. On the other side, what you'll see is stroke subject, and they'll have lots of problems moving. Their movements are jerky. They have large errors in trying to reach and attain the goal. They'll be slow to move. And so you can just visually see the profound difference in their performance between a stroke subject and a control subject. So we'll end that video and then go to some. Now we go to the visual. This is just an example of the data that was displayed. Here's a healthy control subject showing point by point movement. Subject on the stroke is on the right. And again, the jerking movements, large variability that is present. And from there, we look at that raw data, and we can now start to calculate a wide range of information about how they perform. So the diagram here is showing 12 different parameters that we can quantify about reaching movements. The diagram is showing movements of a stroke subject from the start central target to a peripheral target. You can show that there's a large error at the beginning. There's lots of wiggles of corrective movements, and we can quantify and stratify lots of different features about their motor performance on each and every trial. Some of the data, one of the ones we found very useful was the movement direction error. So that first initial movement, trying to go to the spatial goal, how far off in angular degrees. Healthy controls are marked as circles, and the gray area is showing what's healthy performance for the affected arm and non-affected arm. For strokes, for healthy controls, it's simply the dominant versus non-dominant. And what you can see is a small amount of error, about 5 degrees is normal for a healthy control. And then the stroke subjects are marked as triangles, either a triangle pointing to the left is a left-affected stroke, and triangles pointing to the right is right-affected strokes. And you can see that a large number of them have large errors in their movement directions. Interestingly, many of the left-affected subjects, so they have strokes on the right cerebral cortex, actually have impairments in both the affected and non-affected arm. And we actually found almost half of the left-affected subjects had impairments bilaterally. Another thing we can get with the data is to actually compare between the two limbs. It turns out it's extremely valuable for developing quantitative tools, is just to compare the two limbs. So this is looking at reaction time for them to respond to the peripheral targets. The gray area is, again, the healthy performance. And what you can see is the average time for movements for both arms ranges from under 300 milliseconds to 500 milliseconds for healthy controls. There's a broad range in healthy performance. So what's different is the difference in the performance of the two limbs, and that's on the y-axis, that's the time difference. And what you can see is that healthy subjects show very similar times for both arms. If they move quickly with the right arm, they will move quickly with the left, and slow, they'll move with both. So the difference in the time is only down to 50 milliseconds. And that allows us to identify subtle but significantly impairments in very small changes in reaction time between the two limbs. In some cases, as small as 70 milliseconds, we'll identify them as having an impairment. This is an example of a subject that did 16 targets. This is some of our early preliminary data, and this was a chronic stroke. And this subject complained they took his driver's license away. And what you can see is that while they had troubles moving their paretic limb, what you see is some targets they actually rarely moved at all. And that would be to the upper left quadrant. And so this is a very good reason why they lost their license. And you can see it quite quickly here. And that is that they just don't respond to targets over on the left field. And so this is just another quick example of how this type of technology easily quantifies these types of impairments. The other value for this is to give longitudinal analysis of performance. This is an example of a subject who the clinical scores, which we use the Shadoke-McMaster score, were scores of 7 and 7 for the left arm and right. You can see the impaired where it's 3 and 2, so that's a substantive amount of impairment. This is assessments done 4 weeks after stroke and 5 months, and what you can see is those scores are effectively the same. Shadoke-McMaster is very similar to the Fugle-Meyer for those that are familiar with it. So they didn't change their clinical scores, but if you look at the right arm, you will see that actually their performance has improved to a degree. The movements are a little straighter in the bottom panel for the right arm and less variability. So they have still improved and we're able to quantify that. Now moving on from motor skills, we wanted to look at other aspects of brain processing. And a particular area of interest was the area of somatosensation. And this is processed in parietal lobe. And we use sensory information coming from the limbs for doing things like motor actions, doing your buttons on your shirt. But it's also important for body image to have awareness of where our limbs are in space. And so we want to develop a task that would address this. So this is a video of a matching task. What it is going to show is a healthy control subject where the robot is going to move the right arm and two locations in the workspace. And the subject was instructed to move their left arm to a mirror position. So if the arm goes out to the right, they have to, the right arm, then for the left arm, they have to move it out to the left. And this is to look at their ability to know where their limb is in space. So we can move on from that slide and go to some of the data. This is now just showing that data for a healthy control and stroke subject. Again, robot moved the right arm. What we've done is positioned how the subject moved their left arm, which is their unaffected arm for the stroke. The black dots are showing where they should have positioned their hands. The blue dots and are showing where they actually positioned. And the ellipses are showing the trial by trial variability. And what you can see is a profound difference between the control subject and subject with stroke. Healthy control shows small errors. And fairly small ellipses, meaning fairly good reproducibility of that spatial location. Whereas the subject with stroke had large variability, denoted by the large ellipse, and large shift in the workspace. And so the next slide is just going to show a couple more examples. Two on the left are healthy control subjects, showing the types of variability and errors that a normal healthy subject would do in this task. And the other four are showing examples of strokes. And you can see very different patterns of impairments from some subjects showing very large ellipses, the top right panel, where this person's trial by trial variability is enormous. You can have systematic shifts in the world, which is shown in the bottom right panel. And you also can show in the middle bottom panel an example of how the world's actually shrunk. So these are all unique patterns that can be observed in these subjects with stroke. This is a control subject. She's a lady that was in her 80s. She passed all the traditional clinical measures. We collect a lot of healthy control subjects to use as normative data sets. She performed this matching task, and the opened triangles and objects are where she should have placed her hand. The blue icons are showing where she positioned them. And we'd never seen a healthy control have this much of a shift in the world. We talked to her physician. She had a CT scan and ended up having a cerebellar infarct and a dural-based tumor. So one thing we wanted to look at, because we're now thinking of using some of these tasks for rehabilitation, was how much does vision should improve, you would think, this limb matching task. And so what we did was we performed this limb matching task with and without vision. On the x-axis is their performance without vision, and on the y-axis is with vision. What you can see is these are all stroke subjects. The circles are those that fell within the healthy range, and you can see them marked by the grayscale or better. And this is for systematic shift. What you can see is the subjects, as you would have probably guessed, is that when you added vision, you would expect them to improve their limb matching capabilities. And that's what all the green icons are showing, is those subjects that had shift errors in the position of the limb that improved when they added vision. The unusual thing is the red subjects, or the red icons. These are subjects that actually had normal limb matching capabilities, normal proprioception. When they were given vision, they actually created a systematic shift, and all of a sudden now were identified as impaired. And it suggests these are a very unique group of subjects that actually have normal proprioception when it's based on limb afferent information, but that this gets distorted when vision is tried to brought in with it, which is an important thing because it says these subjects have a very more complex sensory motor or multi-sensory integration problem that's related to the visual integration. Now the idea is to go across multiple tasks. And so the idea is here is looking at performance of subjects across the visual guided reaching task and the limb matching task. And what we found was if you look at these subjects, you can see all possible combinations. They're not correlated between the sensory and motor impairments. Some subjects are not impaired in either. Some are impaired in both. But you could equally find subjects that were impaired in only one task or the other. And these are the four example subjects here where they have different combinations of impairments. So there's no correlation between the impairments in either task, but both of these tasks correlate with the FIM score, which is your measures of daily activity, suggesting that these subjects or this impairment in limb position sense is impacting their ability to do daily activities, and that's important to consider. Sorry, this diagram got messed up a bit in exporting into PowerPoint, but this was some data where we're trying to see if we could predict future capabilities of stroke subjects with various different markers, and we used a bit of a mathematical model called fast orthogonal search, and we were trying to first predict both the FIM intake score or the FIM discharge score. And so what we did was for the FIM intake, we predicted using this math model, either using traditional clinical measures like Shadoke Master Stroke Assessment Scale, Purdue Pegboard, Modified Ashworth, and see how well we could predict. And we also took our reaching and matching tasks and looked at how well we could predict. And it turns out that actually the traditional scores did a little bit better for predicting the FIM intake score. What was interesting was the fact that for prognosis about where these subjects are going to be at discharge from rehabilitation programs, the robotic measures actually gave a lot more information, in fact, improved a lot the ability to predict. In fact, they were significantly better than either the traditional clinical measures, or in fact, if you tried to predict based on what their FIM intake score was. Now, clinical exams often have what I call fairly simple patterns of instructions, like touching your nose. There's not a lot of complexity, but as the diagram on the right shows, when we act in the real world, it's a very complex environment. And so those are the things one has to deal with if you're going to have people be able to go back to do activities in the real world. So we wanted to try to develop tasks that would get at this problem of trying to quantify more complex and rapid motor decisional processes. So we came up with this task, which will be shown on the video that you will be clicked on here. And it's an object hitting task. And what this diagram is showing is three different subjects, a healthy control subject and two stroke subjects. What we've done is there is paddles located at the hands of the subject. And they are instructed when the balls move towards them in the workspace, they are to hit them away. And you can actually feel the balls. They feel like little squash balls as you push them away, so you get nice haptic feedback. And what you can see is the task starts very easily so that we make sure all subjects can hit some balls and therefore have no floor effects. But you'll see the task will get more complicated with time, and all of a sudden there'll be more balls falling, they're going to move quicker, and all of a sudden it's requiring the subjects to move, contact the balls more quickly, and to manage a lot of different decisional processes, not only about hitting a ball, but keeping track of other balls that are acting in the environment. You can see the stroke subjects by now show very profoundly different patterns. You have the stroke subject on the top right. You can see is what I call a standard rational approach. The subject has an impairment on the right side. Their left arm, they're going to use most of the workspace to try to hit the balls. The subject on the bottom is a subject with spatial neglect, and you probably should notice by now that they've effectively ignored the entire left part of the workspace. Their left arm is impaired, they rarely use it, and the one arm that could actually help them the most is now squished over the right side of the screen. And so you can just visually see a profound difference in the three different subjects here. So we can close that video, and then I'll go and show a visualization of the data from that task. This is the object hit task, and this is now just showing the data. The each row, there's 10 spots the balls were falling. The top row is showing the balls that fell at the beginning when it was really easy. And the bottom row is when the balls were falling very rapidly. And what you have is the left hand is blue if the left hand hit it, and red if the right hand hit the ball. And the black means that the subject did not hit the ball at all. They missed the ball. So the healthy control subject is using the right hand just a little bit more. That's because they were right-handed, so that tends to happen. And you can see that they have errors, and they tend to be focused on the most extreme left and right sides, because that's actually a good choice when things get hard. It costs a lot to try to move that far out to the periphery, so they tend to make sure they focus on the ones in the middle of the workspace. Stroke subject number one, you can see that this subject missed a lot more balls. They're very asymmetric, and they're predominantly using the left hand. And the stroke subject two, you can see this spatial neglect. You can see that they're hitting some balls in the left side of the workspace, just a few at the beginning, but then that seems to diminish. So as the task gets more complicated, they tend to focus even more attention over to the right side and ignore the left. And so about 85% of all stroke subjects are identified as impaired in this task. The other good thing about this task is it has a very good inter-rater reliability, where most of our parameters stay above 0.9. We've also sort of pushed that type of paradigm further with trying to add cognitive load. And the idea is to stress the brain. And this is thinking about areas like concussion, where you are trying to see if they can manage a large volume of different complex situations. So in this case, we simply ask that you have to hit two objects, and you must avoid all the others. And they perform the same task. And now they have to not only worry about just hitting objects in the environment, they actually have to handle attentional processes to decide what is the object, whether they should hit it, then as well as if it is an object they're not supposed to hit, they have to avoid it in the workspace. We've also shown, or the idea was to show, that you can take standard tasks like trail making and port it onto a computer-based environment. And so we have also done that just to illustrate that you can put lots of different existing tasks onto this platform. And the idea is to try to create one-stop shopping of having many different sensory, motor, and cognitive processes being assessed simultaneously. Some of the future directions we're going is to continue to expand the capabilities and brain circuits that we can assess with this technology. The idea is it's a general purpose platform. So this task here is called a ball on bar task. It's basically you have a bar that connects the two hands. You physically feel the bar in the workspace and the ball, and the dot is on top of the white dot, and you simply are instructed to move to the red dots in the workspace as quickly and accurately as you can. And what we do is we change the complexity of the task. So at first the ball is fixed. Next levels we have that if you tilt the bar, then it will roll. And then we finally allow the ball to roll and make it more complex. And the next video is going to show you an example of a video of this task in which a healthy control and stroke subject are both trying to move in the workspace with this ball rolling. And you can see the healthy control can move to each of the locations fairly easily and maintain balance on the with the ball. But the stroke subject, by having difficulty keeping their hands aligned, starts to have the ball roll and gets into problems. And so eventually the ball starts to fall and roll off the workspace. Okay, we can close that. And This is now just showing some data on the types of information we can grab from that. We can get information on global performance, like how many targets did they hit in a specified time. In this case, they had a minute to do each level, and there is six levels. And we build a Q-sum curve of healthy controls. So for level one, healthy control subjects will hit between 20 and 35 targets. The red line is showing the cumulative sum of all the stroke subjects, and you can see that 88% of the stroke subjects could hit less than the number observed for healthy controls, which is about 21. So that gives you global performance. We can also look at other aspects of, okay, why are they failing and why are they having problems, to try to get into the underlying deficits and impairments in the brain. One is just simple, how tilted is the bar when they're trying to do this task? You can see that healthy controls, the black line is the Q-sum for healthy controls, and you can see that they have only a small tilt, less than 5-10 degrees, whereas the stroke subjects often have large angles. They can't keep the bar aligned in the horizontal plane or in the coronal plane. So 50% illustrate this problem. Another is we can look at how they're performing the task with the two limbs, and this is shown on the hand path length on the top right. And basically, some subjects, instead of moving their hands the same amount, they will actually move one arm more than the other to try to solve, to move the bar around in the workspace. And so that's shown on the panel on the right. The length of the bar is, length of the path is much different between the two limbs. Another task that we've got into, and again, takes advantage of the ability of the robot to apply perturbations in the environment. And what you can see is we'll go to the next video. This is to look at really transcortical and spinal feedback processes to see if they're intact. So the video is now going to show a control subject. The control subject's on the left side of the video, and the subject with stroke is on the right side. I missed putting those labels on. But you can see there's a profound difference in the performance of the subjects. You see the healthy control when this load is applied by the robot. It's a constant load that comes on, and all you have to do is adjust your motor patterns to get your hand back to the target, and you can see it does not disturb them very much. Whereas the subject with stroke is very delayed in making these corrective responses, and so you can see the very large hand trajectories that pull the hand away from the goal, and it takes them a lot longer to get back to the central target that they have to keep their hand at. That's the instruction. So for this data, so if you close the video, we'll go to the next slide. And what you can see is the corrective responses for these two different subjects. And you can see the small corrective, rapid corrective responses that are possible by the healthy control in the top row, so that they quickly get back within a few hundred milliseconds. Whereas the subject with stroke will often show much longer time periods to try to finally counter the load and come back. In this case, the subject was delayed and didn't get back till 800, 1,000 milliseconds. And the other interesting thing is that often we see bilateral problems with making these corrective responses, which is now, I'll show in the slide after this. This slide here is simply showing some parameters that we extract for this task. Deceleration time, how long does it take for them to try to stop and slow down the arm from moving away, as well as endpoint error, how far away were they from the target, central target. In this task, I should have mentioned, they do not have vision of the hand on most of the trials, so it's only using limb afferent feedback. So from this, what you can see is the data. Deceleration time is the panel on the left. All the small gray circles and the bars are showing what the healthy performance for control subjects that we've put through this task as compared to age. So healthy controls always will decelerate within 400 milliseconds. And you can see the stroke subjects that are denoted by the triangles actually often show much slower response times. Panel on the right is the endpoint errors. And you can see that many of these subjects keep their arms far, far away from the central target. They aren't making corrective responses back to the central goal. As I briefly mentioned, what's interesting is that even though stroke impacts one side, one of the two hemispheres, we often found subjects had bilateral impairments. So these are just showing examples of data for the non-dominant or affected arm, and that's on the x-axis. And we then have the unaffected arm on the y-axis, or in this case, the dominant arm for the healthy controls. So the small circles is healthy control performance. So they're all down in the bottom left quadrant. So that's, say, for deceleration time, it's less than 400 milliseconds. Red icons you see are affected in the affected arm is impaired, but not the unaffected arm. And the purple ones are the ones where they actually show impairments in both arms, the impaired, affected, and unaffected arm. The one on the right is simply showing the same basic principle, except for this case is for the endpoint errors. So this is the last part of the talk. I want to try to get into sort of future directions we want to go, but also thinking about how to make this available and translate into more general capabilities and use by other researchers. And the key thing is trying to automate it and automate these tasks and processes. So we've put a lot of time into developing a number of tasks, visual guided reaching, the arm matching, object hit. So a number of different tasks have automated processing for each of these tasks to extract a number of different parameters on for each different behavior. And then the bottom right panel is this neurological report, which basically gives a readout of how this subject performed and have it compared to healthy control performance on whether they are within the healthy range expected for that individual or not, in a very simple automated way. A key of doing this automation has been for us to focus on identifying what does healthy performance look like. So we have put through several hundred subjects in many of these tasks to look at what the influence of age, sex, and handedness is. And getting that information, we then develop regression models to consider the influence of these factors so that when we assess a subject, we can say that is their performance normal or not based on the fact that they are a 55-year-old male. Now, we've also started to expand the number of tasks. The key thing is thinking about this technology as being able to cover a broad range of sensory, motor, and cognitive processes. So right now, in a lot of the research projects we're doing in Queen's University and with clinicians there, as well as collaborations at other locations, such as at University of Calgary, we're now using a package of 10 different tasks that are trying to span a range of sensory, motor, and cognitive processes. So in the sensory area, we have the limb matching task. We have a kines task, which is a kinesthetic test to measure a sense of limb motion, as well as the postural perturbations to all give you different aspects of sensory, limb sensory processing. On the motor side, we have the visual guided reaching, ball on bar and the object hit to give different aspects about limb, upper limb motor function. And we have a number of tasks that focus on cognitive domains, including the trail making, we have spatial span, object hit and avoid, which gets at the attention and inhibition processes, as well as a visual reverse task, which from the literature and other researchers have shown, is basically what you do is if your arm moves to the right, the cursor moves to the left, so you have to learn to reverse your natural sensory motor action, and that's been shown to be indicative of mild cognitive impairments. So we've added that as well to the suite. And with all these tasks, we are now, as many other groups at other locations, are covering a broad range of using this technology to see different neurological groups and whether they, what's the phenotypes or patterns of impairments that can be observed. So we have studies going with cardiac arrest, cerebellar dysfunction, CP, concussion, fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, and a number of other areas to see how this technology might be of value. Now, one of the problems as we develop more and more tasks is eventually we're going to run into the time problem. A subject with stroke can fatigue easily, so there's only so much time you have to try to quantify and assess them. So we're starting to think about expert and more sophisticated ways of collecting the data. And the idea, for example, one of them is to develop a hierarchy of behavioral tasks, where we may have them perform a few initial tasks, like say trail making, object hit, and limb matching task. From there, be able to use expert systems that make decisions about from how they performed in those tasks, what are the best next tasks that they should perform, tasks that we know they will pass based on what they performed in the initial task we shouldn't bother or waste time with. Instead, we should focus where we think some of the impairments are going to be more likely to occur, perform those tasks, develop further expert systems that then can try to link the functional impairments, identifying what we think the subject's problem, for example, is sensory processing, and we think the lesion location is here and about this size. On that note, I'm trying to identify lesion location and size. We've been collecting a lot of imaging data, so for many of our subjects, we have MRI images of their lesion size and location and are now trying to correlate each of our tasks to the underlying locations of the lesions. Now, robots, I think, have great potential, but there's many other things that other technologies, I think, are going to have to be involved and engaged with. Eye tracking, there's a lot of circuits in the brain that are used and focus on oculomotor control. And so one thing we have done is we actually integrate eye tracking technologies into the robotic system so we can start to look at how they're using their eyes as you do upper limb motor tasks. We've also whole body tasks. Robots are really good for upper limb function, but clearly for thinking about a broad-based approach to quantifying brain function, we will have to use and measure whole body capabilities. And that's where motion tracking technologies have moved along quite well. And so they're even getting into motionless tracking. And I see it's got great value and needs to be integrated so that you can study many of the degrees of freedom of the limb or lower limb locomotion, gait, balance control. So there's going to be a need for pushing and using that technology as well as the limb robotic technology. We've also taken the robotic technology and modified it so that it can go up and down. And now we can study postural control, have force plates measure their postural capabilities while they're performing the various voluntary tasks we do to look at a much more broader motor circuits when they're performing these tasks or various tasks. Now, I focused on trying to look at robots and using them to quantify impairments. And in many ways, I would say what we're trying to develop is the gold standard. The costs are very high, they on the one side, but they're also capable of giving a very comprehensive assessment because we can not only measure the movements, but we can apply loads, and that gives us a lot more capabilities to assess things. There are people looking at using gaming technologies, computers, phones, even to get information about the capabilities and neurological impairments. And I think there's actually a good role for those. They give less information, but the costs are clearly far lower. And therefore, I see in the hopeful and long term is that there's actually going to be a hierarchy of technologies that probably will work together. Initial assessments can start with phones, computers to give low-cost information. If their problems are identified, then people can move through into the more sophisticated analysis techniques, such as what we're trying to develop with robots. And the last point I wanted to make is cost. And so these are not cheap technologies, there's no doubt. But the fact is many other technologies clearly have a huge, profound impact. Imaging technologies, of course, have huge capabilities to provide lots of information on the structure of the brain and other organs. They are very, very expensive technologies, but they are have their value because of what they can do. If robots are going to move into the healthcare system, clearly there is a strong need that we have to demonstrate that there is real value for this type of assessment. And that will take a lot more research to identify impairments and how that actually is going to guide patient care in the future. So for an overview, I've tried to talk about potential of robotics for neurological assessment. And I've tried to go through a number of different tasks, visual guided reaching, limb matching, and a few other tasks to look at what I think is the potential of using this technology for clinical assessment. And then I tried to go through some of the future directions. Last slide is to acknowledge the many people that have been involved in this from my research lab. Many of the technicians that have been involved in the development of the technology, as well as some of the grad students, Mustafa Mustafavi, he was involved in the data mining technologies, and several others that were involved in quantifying the impairments. Another key colleague is Sean Duclos, at the Hotchkiss Institute, where a lot of our clinical data was collected. Last thing, and I forgot to mention at the beginning, of course, please submit questions and I will be able to answer them right now. So thank you for your time. So I'll go to the questions and answers. So the one question I have sitting here is, many older subjects are rather machine phobic to begin with. Do many subjects impaired or not exhibit stress or resistance related to the testing environment? That's a really good question, because we were quite worried about that. In fact, the other one we were quite worried about is anyone that would be claustrophobic, because you have to, as you saw in the video, you sort of get brought into this machine. And the answer seems to be not, it doesn't seem to be a big problem for us. We have put in a lot of subjects all the way up, you know, well into their 80s, and we've had very few that have had problems. So that doesn't seem to be as much of a problem as initially. I think out of about 1,000 subjects we've probably gone through, I know of one subject that got claustrophobic and had to come out. But other than that, it hasn't been a major problem. And most people, when they do the task, I suspect there's a bit of stress when they begin, but they find out that it's fairly easy. They still can move in the environment, and so they tend to enjoy their time, particularly the tasks where they get to hit the objects. Most people seem to like those tasks because they're fun to do and fun to play with robots. So that's the one question. If there's any other ones, I can certainly ask or respond if anyone has any more. If not, then I would like to thank you all for joining to this session and listening to the talk. The last thing I'd like to mention is the for CME credits that you need to go to the website listed below for you to be able to get those educational credits. So thank you very much for your time. Oh, could I repeat again? Could I repeat again about the CME credits? I will assume. If not, please send again. So if you want to get CME credits, then you need to go to the website listed on the slide that is presented right now on the screen. I have another